Good morning, everybody. My name is Randy St. Clair. We're out here at Baylands Park this morning with the Plus Size VTOL. Now, the Plus Size VTOL is actually the second in the Go Big at Flight Fest series. And by that, I mean airplanes that are just big for having fun at Flight Fest, typically 8-foot wingspan or larger. The first one was a 12-foot wingspan B-17. And this one is a vertical takeoff and landing, or a VTOL. Now, as you can see, it's made out of this Artec foam, so there's a whopping $11 worth of foam here, available, in my case, at the home improvement store. And then, of course, there are all the electronics and so on, but that's all reusable and can be used on any number of aircraft. And by the way, pretty much all of the electronics here are available through the Flight Test. Got to keep those straight. The Flight Test store. These are the standard motors that they use. They're large size motors for regular airplanes. And the Blue Heli 30 amp ESCs are the standard ones they sell on the website. So it's really a Flight Fest design, or Flight Test design. So let me show you some of the other electronics here. We'll start down in this area. The most important thing I would say is this KK2 flight controller. Now, that's a standard KK2.1.5. It's available from Hobby King. And as you can see, it's mounted in this way with the buttons on top. And you might think that's kind of awkward because you'd have to stand on your head to use it, but there's actually a plan, and I'll show you that later. I've got this input from the flight controller, or from the receiver. Here's the receiver, a little orange receiver, which in this case is outputting S-bus on the bind plug. We're going through a little digital signal inverter here, cable, also available through Hobby King, inexpensive stuff. Plugs into the number 3 port, which is designated the throttle port. So that's the only input that's necessary from the receiver. Then we have all these various outputs, and there's 8 of them. And that's because there's 4 motors and 4 servos. So the motors, and they're actually labeled here. You can see if you get a high shot, you'll be able to see there's a number where my finger is. So we've numbered them, one on top, and I say on, it's actually in the front is what I should say. So this is number 1. Number 2 motor is over there. Number 3 is down here. And number 4. And then we count the servos 5, 6, 7, and 8. So they just go around in from this view from a in a clockwise direction. So let's see, I forgot to mention, we've got a couple of batteries here. These are 2 3-cell, 3.3 amp hour batteries that are in parallel. So there's a total of 6.6 amp hours here. And that's good for between, say, 5 and 7 minutes of flight, depending on how hard you push it, how much hovering you do, and how much forward flight. I think I also forgot to mention that we've got an extra satellite receiver. And while I'm here, let me point out the antennas. Because this foam has a metallized mylar surface, it's probably flashed the camera by now, it's probably RF opaque. So in order to get the receiver antennas as far away from the this metallized surface, we have these nice little tubes here jammed into the foam. These antennas, the receiving part of the antenna is just the tip here, and they're roughly 90 degrees apart, and then we've got this extra satellite receiver plugged in here. And at least when it's not bent, it's also 90 degrees relative to the others. So it's actually a very simple setup. Oh, and I forgot to mention the servos. These are standard servos available on the Flight Test website. These are the servos they recommend for their Tough Tilt system. So they're a little bit stronger servos as necessary for such a large aircraft. Because it is 8-foot span, but it's only about 5.5 pounds. The external flying wires on this. And we've got a very simple system, but it's quite effective. I don't know how well you can see this on the camera, but this is 40-pound test fishing line, just monofilament fishing line. And you notice if you pluck it, it makes a little bit of a sound. I don't know if you can hear that. But it should sound roughly like the low string on a piano. Now, it's actually tied to these little plates right here. If you might zoom in on that, you'll notice these plates are designed with little notches here. And then we've got this little little piece right here, which is actually made from a heavy-duty paper clip. So let me show you how that comes apart, because this is kind of neat, and it makes it possible to assemble and disassemble this aircraft in about 5 minutes. So let me just walk around the other side here. And I'm going to take this apart. Okay, so that's all it does. It hooks into that little notch right there. And then this bin hooks into that notch right there. So it's real easy because the monofilament's a little bit stretchy. So you simply disconnect this, and let me give you a good shot of what that looks like. I don't know if you can see that well. Okay.
I have an Emmy Award. We can see everything.
Okay. My Emmy Award winning photographer here, by the way. So, and the way this works is really super easy. At each one of these tips, there's a plate, a little plywood plate. It's got little notches in it. And all it does is the monofilament line, and you'll want to come in here where you can get a tight shot on this. The monofilament line simply wraps around the plate. So it goes this way around the plate, and then it slips in behind the plate. Notice how the plate isn't taped down in the at the top. Yeah, I get tangled up here. Okay, so then all you do is you pull the loop tight, and that's how it attaches. So I won't go ahead and disconnect all of them right this minute, but when you want to disconnect them, they just pop right out, and when you want to put it together, so it comes in from the outside, goes around the back, and then around the outside, and always around the notches. So now let me just connect this up again so I can show you one other thing. So first off, so this just connects right here as I showed you before. Now, when you put this thing together, it can be all kind of crooked. So I want to make sure you understand how you straighten it out. And it's really quite simple. You simply grab the wire cable and you push it in the direction you want it to go. By doing so, you release the tension on the loop and allow it to move. So what we do then is we just simply sight the wing to make sure it's square and perpendicular and that we're not twisting it in some way. And once we get it nice and square, which is not difficult to do, then you're ready to fly. So I just want to show you how you adjust these wires. If, for example, the wire on this side was too tight, or I'm sorry, in this case, not tight enough, then you simply push the wire towards the loop. And what that does is it releases the tension on the loop and allows the wire to slip. So now I want to adjust it back the other way. I push it that way. But once it's held tight like that, it doesn't slip, or at least not easily. And it holds plenty well enough for when it's in the air and flying. So anyway, you want to get the airplane nice and square and without pulling any warps into the wings, of course. And that's how you do it. Now, let me take this opportunity to show you some things about how the control system works. Because I can imagine there's going to be some confusion because this is a tail sitter. And tail sitters are confusing. I mean, you have two different orientations you have to fly and two different points of reference. We call them earth reference and airplane reference. So right now I've got my switch set up on my transmitter and on this case I've set it up. So with this switch down like this, this is in hover mode. So let's take a look at how the control surfaces work. And we want to focus the camera on the control surfaces. And you know what? Let's walk around this way so it's easier to understand. So right now we're looking at the top of the wing. And by the way, you can see the colors here. We've got the black on the bottom, the yellow on top. And then the standard, there is no red port left. You know, red on the left and green on the right. And that's kind of important when you're in the air because otherwise, how do you tell which way it's going? So now we're in hover mode and we're in what would be called tail in mode. And that is the bottom is away from us. So when I give up elevator, then as you might expect, you get up or elevons. However, this is where it might get a little confusing because when I give it left ailerons, what I get is what from an airplane perspective you would call left rudder. And that makes perfect sense because right now we're flying in earth reference, so this motion right here, this is roll. Now you might normally think that this twisting motion like this, that this would be roll from an airplane perspective. But when you're flying a quadcopter, and that's what this is, then this is roll. Okay? I'm sorry, I got pitch in there by accident. This is roll. All right. Pitch for a quadcopter, fortunately, is the same as pitch for an airplane. That's this. And then yaw for a quadcopter is this motion right here, this twisting motion. Okay? So we just have to understand how these motions work. And also let me arm the motors for you so you can see how they work. And this is normal for any plus type quadcopter. It's absolutely normal. But now I'm going to run the motors just slowly. I'm not going to fly. And so if I give it left aileron, then you may notice that the right motor speeds up and the left motor has stopped. And obviously the opposite in the other direction. Now if I give it up elevator, the motor that's away from me is going to speed up and the near motor stops, and likewise the opposite direction for down elevator. And now for rudder, or for a quadcopter which would be yaw, the motors on this particular quadcopter are not affected at all, because we don't control yaw with the motors. If we tried to, as they do in the manner of a normal quadcopter, it simply wouldn't work. There just isn't enough torque to get the job done. So instead what we do is we use the control surfaces, which you'll notice they all work together in the manner of what for an airplane would be ailerons, except that for a quadcopter this is yaw. So this is left rudder, or left yaw. So, and for safety's sake, well, you know what, I'll leave it armed. But now what I'm going to do is I'm going to flip the switch and I'm going to go into airplane mode. And by the way, there is an intermediate mode. That's where you would do the calibration. But I'm going to go all the way into airplane mode. And by doing that, I've reoriented it so that it's easier to think of in this orientation. So now it's actually just a regular airplane, and you'll recognize the controls you're probably used to. So this is up elevator. Left rudder is just what you would expect, left rudder in the back. And then ailerons is exactly what you would expect for an airplane, except that the rudders are also ailerons, so I'll call them rudderbons. So we've got elevons and rudderbons. And they all work together, of course. So let's go back to hover mode for a minute. And we've talked about control. Let's talk about stability. So I'm in hover mode. I just flipped into hover mode right now. And now I want to look at the elevon control surface down here and watch what happens when I tilt the plane. You notice how the elevons start to move in an up elevator direction, so it's automatically trying to correct. And the same thing you would notice if I move it this way, only now it's the rudderbons that are moving to try and correct. Now that's not the only correction. Let's arm the motors one more time and run them slowly. And this is a good test to do when you're building the aircraft or, you know, testing it. Just don't put your hand in the propeller. But now if I tilt the aircraft, you see how the high motor stops. Well, depending on how high I tilt it, it will stop. And the low motor speeds up. So it's automatically stabilizing itself. And if I tilt this one up, then of course, once again, the high motor is going to stop and the low motor is going to speed up. So the automatic auto level stability in this case is working as it should. Now there's one more stability that's happening in hover mode. And this is not with the motors. I'm disarming right now, just because I don't want to get hurt. And I don't know if we can see this on the camera, but if I twist this, you may be able to see that the ailerons are actually acting to fight the twist. So I don't know if you can see that or not, but it is happening.
I have an Emmy Award, we can see it.
Perfect, I keep forgetting that. So let's say we're getting ready to fly in the morning. We put the plane together, and we've just installed the batteries, and I'll show you how that works. It's just Velcro here, nothing unusual there. The batteries both go here and have this nice little strap, nothing difficult. There's two of them. And then we've got these two connectors right here. I've got my little voltage monitor, old school. And then we just plug in the batteries. Now, I usually plug this one in first, just as a matter of convenience. And when I plug it in, I'm going to want to leave the aircraft stable for a moment and let the flight controller initialize and determine what level is and so on. And once the first battery is plugged in, it's already powered up, but I just need the second battery for more current. So we'll plug that in. And now we're ready to fly. Oh, I forgot to turn the transmitter on. Always a good idea. Let's just do that right now. Fortunately, the flight controller would be disarmed in a case like that, so it's actually safe. And the flight controller is still, in fact, disarmed. The motors will not run at this point. But of course, I can do my standard down and in motion. Arm the motors. The little LED on the flight controller has come on. It's difficult to see it in the bright sunshine, but now we have power. And now we're ready to go fly. Good morning, everybody. I'm Randy St. Clair, and this morning we're going to fly the plus-size VTOL. That's this guy right here. And we're out here at Baylands Park. The wind's blowing about 0 to 5 miles an hour, maybe a little more in the gusts, but it's coming through these trees, so we got a little turbulence. At any rate, this will be a short flight because later on I'm going to change the programming to more of the advanced mode, or the easy mode, as I call it. But so anyway, let's do it. So I'm just arming with the sticks down and in, as is typical for open aero VTOL. That's the firmware we're using. And here we go. See, we're clear. Okay, so it takes off and now it's just drifting downwind on its own. I'm doing nothing. Well, you can't see it right now, but my thumbs are not even on the sticks at the moment. But let's demonstrate control authority here. So as I said, this is the very easy mode. So it's a very docile quad at this point. And I am flying in what's called a ground reference mode. Let's do it a little bit closer to the ground so you can better see the horizon reference and what I'm doing. And as you can see, I'm also fighting this little bit of a wind here. So it's like laying on its back a little bit, but no problem. And then there's a little bit of a pirouette. I could have done that more beautifully, but let's go ahead and do a transition. So I'm going to go straight into forward flight. I flip the switch, and there it goes. Now you can actually see that turbulence I was speaking of. But it's flying, you know, it's an airplane. I don't need to fly this quickly. As a matter of fact, it's better if you slow it down a little bit. Now in this particular mode, it will not do a loop or a roll, but that's because it's auto level in every axis. So in this particular mode, if I just let it fly, it'll just fly by itself all day. Of course, it'll just keep going in that direction. So I guess what I can do in this mode is I can do some nice flat turns. But not a lot more than that. So as I promised, we're going to keep this one very short because we're going to do the more advanced modes in a minute. So I'm going to bring it in. And we'll just bring it in closer here. Flipping the switch now. And of course, now I got to fight the wind to bring it back here. Now, it can fight the wind. It's not... not entirely a problem. Well, like I said, it can fight the wind, but it's struggling. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go ahead and just put it down where it is. Oh, here we go. We finally got a little break in the wind. Well, let's bring it in closer. We don't have to make it look difficult. And that's a landing. I suppose this is vaguely appropriate. Everybody likes tail sitters and VTOLs, right? So now we're ready for the second flight of the day, and this time I've got a fresh battery. I'm also running, I took 10 minutes to change the programming parameters. I'm now running what is roughly the equivalent of easy mode in hover, which still has auto level. But I'm in the forward flight mode. I'm running in what is, let's call it the expert mode. Not that I'm an expert necessarily, but in other words, we've got full 3D throws available. And even in the hover mode, we've got more throws. So, sorry, they're crashing back there. So we'll be able to better handle this wind that we've got going today. So anyway, without further ado, let's go ahead and get it airborne. So Kazra, I'm going up. So I'm arming down and in. That's with the both sticks down and in. Make sure the motors are running. Okay. I'm feeling a puff of wind right now from my back. Bob, I'm going up.
Okay,
so the hovering part is still pretty much the same as what you saw before. Just nice and docile. However, let's go ahead and take it up and flip into forward flight. Only now it pretty much goes where I point it, which means it's up to me to point it in the right direction. So it's quite aerobatic. And it's adequate power. Let's see, what can we do here that's interesting? Well, let's take it up just a little higher so I don't get nervous. All right. Yesterday they were doing some very nice flat spins. Let's see if I can do one of those. So there's a flat spin, sort of, kind of, I guess you'd call that. And what else can we do here? Oh, we haven't done a roll yet. Let's try and do a roll and try and make it look not so sloppy. Well, that was a rolling circle kind of thing, which the problem with the rolling circle is I don't really know how to do a good rolling circle. So we'll call that a rolling circle and pretend I knew what I was doing. Let's see, inverted or outside loops are of course no more challenging than inside loops. We do these sort of flop loop things where we take it up and then cut the throttle, let it flop over, and go to full throttle, let it flop over. That just looks like a loop. So what else can we do? Well, anybody can fly inverted, right? I mean, that's no big deal. Oh, that looks more like knife edge. All right, enough of that. The problem with this thing, I mean, it's not a problem, but the problem is you have to fly it through the maneuvers because it'll do whatever you tell it to do. If you tell it to yaw, it's going to yaw strongly. So if you want to do a roll, for example, and you want it to be a nice, straight, clean roll, you have to fly it through the roll and make it a nice, straight, clean roll. And if you're just depending on giving it a lot of aileron and expecting it to do a nice, straight, clean roll all by itself, well, that's what's going to happen. It's going to just sort of arc over a little bit. But, I mean, you have tons of control. You can fix that. You can do whatever you want. You just have to make it do it. So, let's see. I don't usually like to fly really low, especially in when we've got this gusty, turbulent wind coming around through the trees behind me here. But for the benefit of the camera and for the benefit of a sense of scale, because after all, it's an 8-foot wingspan, and it'll certainly do it, of course. Now, I should also mention that there is no need to fly fast. I mean, it's got all this wing area. It only weighs about 5.5 pounds. It's got plenty of power, but if you're using all that power in forward flight, all you're doing is churning propellers and wasting battery. So it's just not necessary. All right, what haven't we done so far? I don't think we've done any stall turns. That was sort of a stall turn. Of course, it tons of control authority, so it'll do them all day. All right, let's bring it in while we still got lots of battery left. And I'll go ahead and bring it back here. And then I'll flip into hover mode. And just because it's easier for me, I'm gonna hover it, for a quadcopter would be considered tail in. And now we've got a little break in the wind, which makes the landing easier. Not that it was difficult. So as long as we're here, let's do just a little bit more in the hover mode, because for those of you who haven't flown tail sitters before, they don't like wind in general, and not as compared to other VTOL types. And takeoff and landing are actually the only real hard part for wind. Otherwise, they're just airplanes. But like right now, for example, there's a gust of wind coming through from my back. So if I were to take off slowly or very gently, then it would basically tip over. You can see it was starting to tip over there. And so you don't want to do that. What you want to do is you want to just jump it off like you mean it. So then it comes up straight and everything's fine. Now, likewise on landing, what you don't want to do is scrub around close to the ground. What you want to do is get down close and then drop it. So once it touches the ground in any way, cut the throttle completely and let it drop. Otherwise, you'll blow over. What also you don't want to do is land when you're going downwind or drifting like this, because this is what'll happen. Well, in that case, nothing happened. But what'll happen is it'll just tip over. And not that tipping over is the worst thing in the world. As a matter of fact, just because I'm feeling foolish, let's tip it over. Okay, so there's a tip over. Now, I don't imagine we did any damage at all, but not even a busted propeller. And why would it? I mean, it weighs next to nothing. So that's my words of warning about tail sitters. This one, because it's so big and relatively low to the ground, it takes off and lands quite well, actually. Although I really wouldn't recommend trying this in a 20-knot wind. You probably wouldn't enjoy it. However, I mean, it can handle wind more than this, and this is the worst kind because it's turbulent and from behind me. But what you'll end up doing is you'll end up tilted very strongly into the wind, and then as soon as that forward corner touches the ground, just drop it. All right, enough talking. Let's go look at how it's built. So we just got back. That was a great flight. And now we're going to show you how it comes apart, and you can imagine in reverse how it would go together. So let's start by disconnecting the batteries. And no big deal, just unplug them here. One, two batteries. Physically take them off. Okay, we'll set those aside. Now we'll just hook the Velcro on just so it doesn't get tangled up or anything. All right, now I can turn the transmitter off and set it aside so I don't step on it. All right, now I want to show you how these flying wires work and how easy it is to take apart. So I showed you before, we've got these nice little hooks. They just hook in right here. So I just disconnect that and just walk around the plane and unloop the flying wire here from the loops. Very easy to do. Just try and keep it from getting tangled up or stepping on it. And we'll just set that aside. You may notice this is actually one long loop of monofilament fishing line, 40 pound test monofilament fishing line, and that's why it's so easy to put on and take off. You don't have to put on separate wires. Now there are two of these wires, one in the back, and that's the one I've just disconnected. So I'll just throw that out there for now. And then I'll disconnect the other one. And that's how easy that is. Just unhook it, unloop it from these plywood tip plates here. Now I'm going to make it look difficult. Okay, and now we've got one long monofilament fishing line for the other wire. And that's all there is to it. We'll just set that aside here. And now, we're ready to take off the verticals, as I call them. Except we need to first unplug the cables, so we've got the power connector to the ESC. And then we've got one servo and the control for the ESC, which is right here. Plugs into the flight controller. Okay, so now that is fully disconnected. And then it's just held on by Velcro. And it's literally that easy to take apart. And we'll do the same thing on the other side. One power connector, one servo connector, and one signal to the ESC. Take off the Velcro. And now the plane is in three pieces and ready for transport, except there's one more step, and this is just a convenience. Because we've got these long lines and they're attached right here, what I like to do is take the line and just wrap it around the plane, just like this, wrap it right through the same notches that we were using before, all the way back around, and then back around again. And right here I have placed conveniently this little patch of Velcro right here. So now I just slip that in there and put the little piece of Velcro on top just to hold it. And now it's conveniently located for transport. Just slip that under the power wires. And of course I have to do that one more time. I'll do that with this wire, which just for convenience I'll attach it to the top one, because I don't like to bend over that far. And then we'll go back to the bottom one again and back to our second patch of Velcro. We'll put that on there. And now the wire is nicely stored for transport. Now, I should mention one more thing. If this size, which is, this is 8 feet long, so that's a little bit inconvenient to transport. If you wanted to, and I didn't do it in this case, but if you wanted to, you could fairly easily cut the foam right here on this side of the line and then attach it with Velcro. And then the rest would be the same as what you see right now. At which point these pieces would only be approximately 4 feet long, and that would be a little easier to transport. And by the way, I should mention that one of the basic ideas of these flight test or flight fest designs is that they might be a group build. That is, you would actually build them with your friends at Flight Fest. And in order to make that a reasonable activity, you'd want to be able to complete the build in a day or less. You might even be able to build this thing in a half a day. The catch is, you really want to build it at home first, figure out how everything works, get the flight controller programmed, make sure that you understand it and you're happy with it, and then just take the parts that you need to Flight Fest without the foam. I'm assuming maybe you're coming from somewhere across the country, you don't have room in your car or whatever for all this foam, but you can buy the foam once you get there, and it's only $11 worth of foam. So then all you have to do is tape it together. By the way, there's nothing here but tape. A little tiny bit of glue, a little foam safe CA is used to attach those control horns. Everything else is just tape and a little Velcro. So you could easily build this with your friends and then have quite a fun aircraft to fly at Flight Fest. That's the point of all this, fun at Flight Fest.